Hello, everyone. It's great to see a full house. Everyone's very excited about John Adams, so very excited about today. So again, today we're going to be talking about John Adams and his, you know, in part his remarkable career, you know, one of the real, at the vanguard of the American Revolution, one of our earliest American diplomats, primary framer of the Massachusetts Constitution, our first vice president, our second president, really remarkable man. You know, I really couldn't have two better authors to talk about him. You know, just first, just want to say we have some really amazing programming coming up. You should check out the listing of the upcoming programs. We have one for members only next week on congressional term limits. We have additional public programs on everything ranging from the constitutionalism of the Civil War to policing with leading expert from NYU, Barry Friedman, and on. So please check out that program, the program to see what's coming up, our various events. And also, if you're interested in becoming a National Constitution Center member, please visit the table right outside the theater here. And you know, again, we're a little late starting, so just want to get right into the program. I just ask that right now you please, everyone, silence your cell phones. And so, without further ado, we're going to be talking about two books here today, broadly about John Adams. Both of them touch really upon his account of aristocracy and about his life more generally. First, we have Luke Mayville's John Adams and the Fear of American Oligarchy, and then Richard Allen Ryerson's John Adams's Republic, the One, the Few, and the Many. So I please give a very warm National Constitution Center welcome to Luke Mayville and Richard Allen Ryerson. Well, Dick and Luke, thank you so much for being here. I'm really excited for this conversation. I must confess up front that my view of John Adams is shaped to an inappropriate extent, probably, by my own obsession as a high school student with the musical 1776, which famously at one point describes John Adams as, quote, obnoxious and disliked. And so, Luke, I just want to start with you. You've spent a lot of time with John Adams. Can you tell us a little bit about John Adams, the person, how he compared to the other founders?
Yeah. I suppose the impression from 1776 is better than the impression from Hamilton, which leaves him out entirely.
So, that's fair enough.
And the only brief mentions of him are making fun of him, basically. So, well, I come to the study of John Adams from the perspective of a political scientist. And what really brought me to John Adams was the recognition that he wasn't just a founding father figure, president, a statesman, who also had some ideas about politics. He really was something like a political scientist in his own time. He was a rigorous, analytical, political, and social thinker. And I really came to think that John Adams deserves to be thought of among, you know, what we think of as the first-rate political and social thinkers in American history. So the thinkers who you might study in college today, like in even 20th century thinkers like John Rawls or Hannah Arendt or W.E.B. Du Bois, John Dewey, those who are thought of as probing most deeply into big questions of society and politics, John Adams deserves to be thought of among that list and not just as a historical figure, not just as a statesman. And Adams really did. The major work of political science that he wrote, The Defense of the American Constitutions, was probably the most systematic treatment of constitutional theory ever written by an American. We have other founding fathers like James Madison, Alexander Hamilton, who wrote, for example, the Federalist Papers, that are also very impressive and also first-rate political thought. But John Adams, really more so than any other figure in the time, was a political scientist. And that's what really engaged my interest.
And so, Dick, in your book, in part, you describe John Adams as, you know, among the folks in the revolutionary generation as sort of most gripped by the past. You know, Lucas talked a little bit about John Adams as a practical political scientist, but what about John Adams as a practical historian of sorts?
Well, this interest of Adams actually began very early. It actually grows out of his interest in law. He begins, of course, as a lawyer, and it's often said that a great many of our founding fathers were lawyers, and that is nominally true, it's technically true. Some of them were lawyers and planters, lawyers and businessmen, lawyers and something else. John Adams, in his early career, was strictly a lawyer, a full-time, very hard-working lawyer. And he became, by 1770, when he defended the soldiers in the Boston Massacre, he was already by that time the leading attorney in Massachusetts, a role that he held until he got into public life in the Continental Congress. As a lawyer, he was determined very early to master a wide range of fields of law, including reading the Institutes of Justinian, so he would learn about continental law. And I think it was from this that he began to get into ancient, medieval, and early modern history, and started reading a lot of history and political science from Europe that his contemporaries did not read. I would point out that one scholar has argued that Adams was the only one of the founding fathers who read anything by Machiavelli except The Prince. I mean, he read The Prince, but the others read The Prince, or they knew about The Prince, and they had a low opinion of Machiavelli. Adams read the rest of Machiavelli and had a quite higher opinion of him and learned a great deal from him. So that's the way I think he comes into his appreciation for the past.
Well, and we're going to dig in detail about here Adams's constitutional vision, but just to place on the table right at the outset here, Luke, if we're looking at the mature John Adams as political thinker, what does his ideal constitution look like, broadly speaking?
Well, one of the big differences between Adams's constitutional thought and the Constitution as we know it is that Adams understood the different parts of government as corresponding to the different parts of society. So Richard's book and the title, this notion of the one, the few, and the many, the society is fundamentally broken down into different parts. And for Adams, government was supposed to reflect that. The governor was supposed to reflect something like the monarchical element of society. The Senate was supposed to reflect something like the aristocratic or the social economic elite element of society. And the popular chamber, that house, what we call the House of Representatives, was supposed to reflect the democratic, the popular part of society. And that's quite different in a fundamental way from the way that we've come to think of the relationship between government and society. With the advent of the Federalist Papers, which are and the kind of argument for the Constitution that we find there, we see a departure from John Adams's constitutional thought, and that people like James Madison and Alexander Hamilton started describing each part of each part of government as representative of the people as a whole. There is one American people. And even though we have a Senate and a House of Representatives, they all represent the people, but in different ways. So we find a kind of eclipse, in a way, in modern constitutional thought of this old idea that was really based on different classes. And John Adams, I suggest in the book, is interesting in this current moment because, in a way, Americans in the last several years, especially as economic inequality increases, are becoming again much more interested in class. and the difference that class makes for politics. That's something that John Adams cared a lot about, and he cared quite a lot more, I argue, than his contemporaries did, many of his contemporaries did.
And so both of you really explore John Adams's view of the few, of the aristocracy. Luke, mm-hmm. your book is largely about that. Dick, you certainly touch on that in yours as well. But beginning with you, Dick, how did John Adams understand the few? What did he mean by the aristocracy?
Well, one thing I find that Adams doing is his thought develops very dynamically on aristocracy, but I think it's a surprise to him himself and how much he becomes interested in this. Up until the Declaration of Independence, he had lived in a society, that is the province of Massachusetts, that had a very visible aristocracy. He did not, I think very consciously about it. And if he had thought about it, if he'd been asked about it, he would have said, well, yes, these are people with more money, more education, and they're doing a good job in the various higher positions of Massachusetts government, culture, society, education, whatever. He would have defended that, particularly in the town he lived in, then called Braintree, now the city of Quincy. The big family was the Quincy family. He admired them, and his own family had been supporters of the Quincys, definitely a rung up above them, for generations. He had no trouble with that. Then the War of Independence comes, and he suddenly sees many men in Massachusetts and all over making a lot of money off the war. I mean, when we think of the war, we think of the great sacrifice of the soldiers on the line and the sailors and the women and children at home. And the war brought a lot of suffering for a lot of people. It made a few people very wealthy. These people were supplying the Continental Army. They were financing the privateers that were seizing valuable cargoes from British ships. And Adams began to look at these people and thought they weren't behaving very well. They were too greedy. They were too arrogant. They were trying to muscle their way into politics at the highest level in Congress. And this is something that he, every single year, for a decade after the Declaration, he thought this more and more, and finally sat down to write the Defense of the Constitutions, which is a defense of the state constitutions in America as they existed in 1786. The point of that book was to argue for strong executives and to argue that aristocracies were threatening and dangerous. They must be controlled, but they couldn't be avoided. They couldn't be defeated. They couldn't be denied. They had to be controlled and harnessed for an effective republic. That's what he argues. So aristocracy is a discovery for him. And I would add that as he goes on in his life, he begins to see a need to define aristocracy in ways that fit America's culture. No titles, no monopolies. Instead, personal qualities, family inheritances, various things like this that gives some men advantages over others. And that's where he ended up on the subject.
And Luke, you mentioned the concerns about economic inequality today and mm-hmm. of the few. And I mean, we see this from across the ideological spectrum, from mm-hmm. you know, supporters of Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders talking about the 1% to, you know, President Trump and his supporters talking about a rigged system or draining mm-hmm. the swamp. I mean, mm-hmm. to what degree did Adams's, you know, diagnosis and account of the few, how is it sort of similar to what we see in political currents today versus dissimilar and unique to his own time?
One of the surprising moments for me in researching this book was when I was flipping through, in an unrelated moment actually, flipping through a book written in the 1950s by a Marxist Weberian sociologist named C. Wright Mills, who wrote a famous book called The Power Elite, which is probably The most authoritative study of American social economic elites in the 20th century. And in a chapter at the very end, he's writing about a certain element of his theory of the power elite. And he says, you know, there's this figure in American history who pretty much already said all of this, and that's John Adams. And he goes on to, you know, quote John Adams, especially another major book called The Discourse on Davila that John Adams wrote while sitting as vice president of the United States. One thing about John Adams' thinking that's very similar to current contemporary ways of thinking about economic elites is that he focused on power. He focused on the power of elites. So, and this was very different than his contemporaries. So on to give one example, many of his contemporaries thought that, you know, the American Revolution had turned decisively against aristocratic titles. And the Constitution had, you know, completely prohibited titles of nobility. So hadn't you pretty much solved the problem of oligarchy and aristocracy? Adams rejected that idea. He thought that even though you had done away with titles, qualities, as Richard was beginning to mention, other qualities, qualities like family name or what he called birth, qualities like physical beauty, and especially wealth would continue to generate a lot of power for elites. And a second part of this, and maybe this is something we could discuss a little bit more because it's in both of our books. A second part of this is he was very skeptical of the notion that many of his contemporaries, especially Thomas Jefferson, had, which was that, yes, we have done away with the old aristocracy, but we have a new aristocracy in America, but it's not a dangerous one. It's because it's merely an aristocracy of talent, or what Jefferson called the natural aristocracy, as opposed to the old conventional aristocracy. So Jefferson said, we now have an aristocracy of talent and virtue. Adams agreed with that notion up to a point, but one of the themes of his late writing, especially his later part of his life, is this idea that actually qualities like wealth and, again, birth and beauty, what he called qualities given to us by fortune, are much more powerful than qualities like talent and virtue, which are, you know, you could call meritocratic or given by merit. And in that sense, he has a very critical view of the power of wealth, the power of family, that wasn't quite held by contemporaries, even writers like Jefferson, who in other ways were very worried about financial elites and things like that.
And so, Dick, we have this in Adams's account, this sort of inevitable few, this inevitable aristocratic class, in a sense, as a matter of constitutional design. How did he think we might control and perhaps even harness the few for good purposes?
Well, I would have to say that I think in terms of Adams' structural solutions to the problem, this may be the weakest part of his whole argument. And anyone who reads my book, I think, would see that I am very deeply in love with John Adams. There's just no doubt about this. But when he came to think about how you would control the aristocracy, he had one solution that made sense, but is certainly open to criticism over time, and that is to have a very powerful executive. Now, he argued that the aristocracy is the natural enemy of a powerful executive, and that a powerful executive is the natural ally of the people. And the republic works well when the people and the strong executive work together to keep the aristocracy under control. And he further said that you could, in fact, do this by putting the aristocracy in a special constitutional body, the upper house of the legislature, the Senate. And they would be, in a sense, ostracized. They'd be where you could see them, you'd keep your eye on them, and so forth. Luke has mentioned in his book that one source of this idea seems to be the writing of Jean Delorme, a Swiss writer who praised the British Constitution. And the ostracism idea may have come partly from that. The reason I say that this is the weakest part of his argument is that, first of all, I think the ostracism idea probably doesn't work particularly well. His notion was, if you get all of the aristocrats into the Senate, they won't be in the House of Representatives, where they will distort and overawe and intimidate the more ordinary kind of representatives, the representatives of less social standing. But, you know, when, particularly when a society gets large, you can have so many aristocrats, a 100-person Senate can't begin to contain them all. They're going to spill over into the House of Representatives, and they already have, a long time ago, actually, not recently. So that I see as a weakness. The strength I see in Adams is that he is telling people, you've got to admit you have an aristocracy. You can't get rid of it. There's no way you can get rid of it. So you have to try to be vigilant against the power of an aristocracy. And that lesson, plus his insistence on a very broad, publicly funded system of education, putting the two things together, I think give the best possibility of control of an aristocracy. I mean, there may be basic limits in a wealthy country, which we certainly are, a large country with a lot of economic interest. There may be certain basic limits into how much you can control an economic aristocracy. But Adams said you have to try and you have to do what you can about this. You know.
Sure, Luke.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that. I share the skepticism about Adams's solution, and one really fascinating point in Adams has this beautiful late correspondence, late in life, retirement era correspondence with Thomas Jefferson that I highly recommend. If there's one set of Adams's readings that you go off and read, you should read the Jefferson Adams letters. But at one point, Adams is writing to Jefferson about aristocracy, and he hints at this, at something like his ostracism scheme. And Jefferson responds and says something like, you think that with a Senate, you can coordinate the aristocrats, but what's much more likely is that the aristocrats will capture the coordinates. So what he meant was that what you are basically doing is handing government over to the aristocrats by ensuring that they have one part of it, and then they're going to likely going to have the whole part. And I think that Adams never really had a compelling response to why that wouldn't happen. And I think arguably something like that has happened. Most of Congress is millionaires. The vast majority, I think, is millionaires. I agree with Richard on this, and I think that the lesson isn't so much the specific institutions that Adams proposed, but it's that it's to raise the question of how is it that we as a society, we as a political system, build institutions or fail to build institutions that can somehow counterbalance the power of social and economic elites. So I would suggest one institution that's been very relevant in this regard in the 20th century was labor unions that served as something like, that served the role of something like what John Adams imagined the popular assemblies doing. They were a political force in society that represented the lower orders and counterbalance the power of the higher orders. Political parties used to do arguably a much more effective job than they do today at organizing the interests of middle class and working class people. There was a time when people, when journalists described the Democratic Party and, you know, the Franklin Roosevelt era, described the Democratic Party and in the House of Representatives that it dominated as the House of Lords for the proletariat. It was a body of government that that gave a kind of affirmative action to working class people, almost in politics. But that's not the case anymore. Both parties, in many ways, are dominated by economic elites. So these are the questions I think that reading Adams, encourages us to ask.
And Dick, you mentioned Adams' vision of a strong executive and his role in his constitutional system. Where did his view of a strong executive come from? I mean, when did he begin to adhere to this? And you know, did it develop at all over time?
It did develop over time, but actually, he came to the belief in a strong executive first, that is, before he started even thinking very much about an aristocracy. In one way, it's a little curious that he did, because he didn't have much use for the royal governors of Massachusetts, particularly Thomas Hutchinson, whom he really hated. Hutchinson was the last civilian governor of Massachusetts, and then Britain put in a general, General Gage, to try to clamp down, which, of course, failed completely. But Adams, I think, had... He thought that a virtuous executive, an executive chosen by the people, could be effective. An important part of this was that he didn't want the executive to be chosen by the legislature. And right as the revolution was beginning to heat up, the various provinces, as they moved to independent statehood, decided we'll have legislatures, and then the legislatures will choose the governor, or even choose an executive council, a plural executive. And Adams said, no, this isn't, plural executive is just going to be weak. You want one executive, you want the executive chosen independently from the legislature. And so when he got his chance to show how it should be done, in 1779, he drafted the Massachusetts Constitution. And in that Constitution, the governor was elected annually by the entire voting population. So he had a separate power base from the legislature. And then he had a Senate and a House of Representatives. And he thought, all working together, that this would work fairly well. I mean, he admitted that it wouldn't be perfect. But he got, actually, toward the end of his life, somewhat optimistic. He said to Benjamin Rush in a letter once, "The Romans and the British have handled best the problem of aristocracy in a government." Then he added, "We may do better than either." He wasn't sure of that. Some days he said, "We'll do great." Other days he said, "Oh, it's going to be a disaster." But he was hopeful these mechanisms would work. That's the best way I could put it, I think.
And I mean, obviously we have, you know, the presidency largely detailed in Article 2 of our Constitution. We also have just the development of the presidency over time, with commentators often speaking of a rise of an imperial presidency in the 20th mm-hmm. and into the 21st century. So, Luke, you heard a little bit about how Dick presenting Adams's vision of the executive. What might he make of, you know, the developments, you know, especially from the 20th into the 21st century? Do these get closer to his vision of the strong executive, or are they altogether dissimilar?
I think it's... This is something that I'm very skeptical about as a part of his theory, because I think if you want to be very generous towards Adams's notion of an executive who would rein in the aristocrats, you can cherry pick American history. So you could say, you could point to Theodore Roosevelt. You could point to talking about the malefactors of great wealth and the need for the strong president to bring them to heel. You could talk about Franklin Roosevelt and describing the economic royalists and welcoming, saying, "I welcome their hatred," and taking on this very antagonistic relationship with the economic elite of his time. But there would be, I would imagine, there would be, it would be just as easy to come up with examples of collusion between elites and economic elites and presidents, and perhaps it, you know, Richard mentioned the influence of Machiavelli. One clear element of Machiavelli's influence is Machiavelli thought that executives always have to choose whether to ally with the few or to ally with the many. And Machiavelli recommends that executives ought to ally with the many because the people will be the most stable basis of support. And Adams seemed to believe that as well. But it doesn't seem like there's a clear mechanism that would force or compel the executive to be the defender of the people. And I don't see that. I see the development of the imperial presidency from World War II to now, perhaps only only making that problem more and more difficult, because in some ways the president amasses more and more power. But it doesn't seem like there is a mechanism in place to determine on whose behalf that power will be wielded.
Did you talk a little bit about the conventional wisdom about John Adams, both in his own day and among historians, as sort of this idea that when he left for Europe, he was a true Republican, he came back as a monarchist. Could you talk a little bit about where that idea comes from and the degree to which those commentators are either onto something or wrong?
I can. I would like to speak just for very briefly about the issue of the executive.
Oh, definitely.
First, and I think as Luke does, I tend to agree that a problem that I think Adams didn't foresee as much as he should have is the power of war and what war would do to the executive, what it has done in this country to the executive. Executives always have the choice of allying more with popular interests, and several of our presidents have done so, both considerably in the past and some rather more recently. But they also always have, since 1941, they have at their disposal a large military, a large military-industrial complex that Eisenhower warned against directly in his farewell speech in 1960. Many presidents, I think, have really succumbed to what has to be done to keep the country safe. They've succumbed to the influence of the power elite, the military-industrial elite, in its various different forms. And that's something I think Adams didn't foresee. And I'm not sure I have any particular solution for it.
Mm-hmm.
But to get to your question, and this was a big part of my book, when did Adams come to have these views, and why did he come to have these views about the executive and the aristocracy? What I call the traditional or orthodox tradition of interpretation is that he went to sail to Europe as an orthodox Republican, no particular interest in aristocracy, wasn't thinking that much about powerful executives, came back as an admirer of aristocracy, European aristocracy, and an admirer of monarchy. Now, it's easy to see why his critics said that. In the Defense of the Constitution, he even has a section on monarchical republics. And he doesn't have many countries in that. Actually, he has two, Great Britain and Poland. One very successful, one not very successful at that time. Adams had actually had that belief about Great Britain from at least a year before the Declaration of Independence. People didn't notice it. In his Novanglis writings in 75, in his wonderful little pamphlet, Thoughts on Government in 76, he made it clear that he thought Britain, constitutional monarchy, was in effect a republic. And people didn't notice that. As for the aristocracy, he got very concerned about that before he went to Europe. The concern grew. It was not because European courts turned his head or anything like this. It was a result of anxieties and problems that he saw at least as early as the mid-1770s in America. And I would add on aristocracy, he becomes concerned with aristocracy exclusively by viewing Americans who he feels are aristocratic, and usually in a negative sense. He writes to Abigail when he's in France in his first diplomatic mission, and he's having trouble with Benjamin Franklin, and he's having trouble with Arthur Lee and a few other people. And he says to her, I must say in perfect sincerity, I have no I have no difficulties with the French nation. He says, all of my difficulties arise entirely from Americans. Mm-hmm. And so that is, I think, from then on, it's always American aristocrats he's worried about. And although we haven't gotten into this yet, I would say that he really stands out as saying, we have an aristocracy in the 80s, the 90s, beyond that. And people like Jefferson and Madison and Washington, major slaveholders, major landowners, saying, no, we don't have a trouble with aristocrats. We have a trouble with Hamilton and some merchant aristocrats. But beyond that, yeah, we don't have a trouble with aristocrats. Yeah. And Adams could not convince them that there was a difficulty.
And we've talked a lot about the few, Luke, what did Adams think was the role of the many in sort of the ideal constitutional system? And how did it relate to sort of the trends we see in American constitutional development, from the 1790s onward, once he's back on the American scene? Mm-hmm.
Well, this is something that is often overlooked by Adams's critics, the role of the many, because what often distinguished Adams in the eyes of his critics, especially as the years went on, is that he kept on talking about the few and the one, the aristocracy and something like the monarchical element of society. And when Americans thought that they had gotten rid of those things altogether. So it was often a point of confusion because his critics saw him as obsessed with the few and the one, but Adams did very much think that the many was maybe was an important and maybe the most important element of the constitutional system, because one of the essential features of a republic, what makes a constitutional political system a republic, is that there is real representation in politics of relatively ordinary people. And that is what popular assemblies were supposed to achieve. They were supposed to actually make the interests, the views, the feelings of ordinary people present in government. And in that sense, Adams is pre-modern because in his time, revolutionaries were starting to think that, the preferences of the many should be all of government, not just one part. But it also, so it makes Adams pre-modern in that sense, but it also makes Adams, you know, a source of critique of our own politics, because we can still ask today, is there even one part of our system that substantially represents the interests of ordinary people? That was the core feature of a republic for Adams. And when he wrote the Defense of the Constitutions, it's full of these histories of republics and these stories of the various ways that aristocrats throughout history had flooded into popular assemblies and corrupted them and eliminated that core feature of republican politics, which is the genuine representation of the people. And I think that as Adams went on later into his life, he very much saw the danger of that happening in the United States.
Thank you so much for that, Luke. And now I'm going to turn to our audience's superb questions, as always. So thank you so much for these. Let's start with this. What was John Adams's reaction to the French Revolution?
Well, he was generally pretty negative about it. I think this has been exaggerated by some of his critics, who they like to think he was really at times obsessed with the French Revolution, with its the great power of its single unicameral assembly, its national assembly, riding roughshod over everyone's rights and eventually getting into a real orgy of violence in the reign of terror under Robespierre. He did, of course, have those feelings about the French Revolution. But at first, he was skeptical but willing to give the French Revolution a little bit of a break. In his discourses on D'Avola, written very early in the French Revolution, he was skeptical, but he said that the real problem was that the National Assembly in France was unwilling to admit any kind of role of the few, even though he said, in fact, they were the few. That is, they were an assembly, they were representatives, they were select. And he says, they say they're going to wipe away everything aristocratic in their culture. He says, does this mean they're going to wipe away all records of the glorious deeds of the National Assembly? He didn't think they would. Later, I have to add one thing, because it's, I think, a very funny remark, and I just did close my book with it. He wrote to Benjamin Rush, he said, have I not been engaged in mischief all of my life? He says, have I not brought on the American Revolution, which led to the French Revolution? And then he adds, but I meant well. So that's enough on that.
That's great. So Luke, anything you want to add about the French Revolution? But I'll also add this question. What might Adams think of PACs, lobbyists, and how modern political campaigns are funded? Easy question, I know. Yeah.
So I'll start with something on the French Revolution. One of the most interesting records we have of Adams is thinking about politics is the various marginal notes that he left in books that he read. So for example, he intricately went through the works of Jean-Jacques Rousseau and wrote all kinds of notes in the margins. And one of the books that he read was Mary Wollstonecraft's History of the French Revolution. And there's one point, and this is just what I found to be an interesting element of his critique of the revolution, where Wollstonecraft is admiring the way that the French revolutionaries were tearing down all the different distinctions in society, all the different ways that, you know, the nobility and the clergy had been set apart and distinguished from the rest of the citizenry. And Adams has the provocative thought that, well, isn't it the case that when you tear down all of the existing distinctions in society, you still leave one standing that will inevitably stand, which is wealth? So isn't it the case that that there will still be something like a natural aristocracy of wealth, even after you've taken all of the honor out of the various offices of government? And I've found that to be a very provocative critique of the French Revolution, because it seems to correspond to some of the populist energies today, which would have us take all of the honor out of public service. You know, put really strict term limits, limits on the number of terms and the duration of offices, in order to, in a way, to denigrate the honor of public office and make office holders merely citizen legislators as opposed to true political professionals of some kind with their own honor. And I think Adams might have a thought on that, that this kind of populist intention could actually backfire, because when you take all of the honor out of public service, you leave standing the honor of wealth. And that becomes, in a sense, the dominant source of honor in society. So anyway, that's something that I really focused on and elaborated in one of the chapters of the book. I don't know if I can say much about campaign finance. What I will say is that Adams actually points us towards a way of thinking about the power of wealth that perhaps is an alternative to some of the focus on the financing of elections and things like that. Because for Adams, the power of wealth wasn't just its ability to purchase influence, whether it's through, funding of elections or the funding of lobbyists or the purchasing of media in our contemporary situation. Adams also thought that wealth was powerful because people admired the rich. People looked up to them. He even called it sympathy for the rich. That there was something about wealth that made it a lot like beauty, actually. Wealth enabled its possessor to stand out in society. He said, at one point he says, and he draws on the theories of Adam Smith here, but he says, wealth glitters with the brightest luster in the eyes of the world. It enables its possessor to stand out apart from the rest of society and to command the admiration of the public. And that was a source of its power. And that's something that is gets us away from just thinking about the kind of material ways that wealth buys influence through campaigns. I think that's all very important, but Adams provokes us in a different direction, I think.
Interesting. This is for either of you. What were Adams's views on slavery?
Well, he did not write very much about slavery. Somebody has argued that Adams was in the 1770s and 1780s, he was not any kind of anti-slave pioneer in Massachusetts, that he had slavery had existed. He did not actually think much about it, but it was really challenged by other people in Massachusetts, and Massachusetts was the first place to essentially outlaw slavery. Based on an article he had written in the Massachusetts Constitution, that is one of the clauses of the Declaration of Rights in the Constitution, then Massachusetts judges took that and said, this declaration of the people being free and equal means there cannot be any slavery in Massachusetts. And that did end slavery within a very few years. Adams had absolutely no quarrel with that. He disliked slavery. His own family did not have slaves. Abigail's family had one or two slaves, but she also came to dislike it. They weren't pioneers in this way at all. But I do find a very interesting angle on this. In late in life, Adams got talking about, got writing to a man named John Taylor of Caroline County in Virginia. And this man was a Jeffersonian, a major slaveholder, a Virginia planter, hated Hamilton and the banks and so forth and so on. And Adams is writing to Taylor about political questions and a lot about aristocracy. And at one point, he talks about the importance of education, and he says, and he's maybe being a little easy on Taylor, and he's also indulging in the language used in Virginia. He usually, almost invariably, refers to Taylor's slaves as servants, as Virginians did themselves. Many Virginians did. They would not use the word slave about their own slaves if they could possibly avoid it. They said that they were servants, you know, sort of implying that the servants could walk even though they couldn't. And he said that, Adams said, he thought education was so important. He says, I would recommend this even for all of your servants. Now what he's really saying here is that all the slaves in Virginia ought to be able to learn to read and write, as well as everybody else in Virginia and everyone else everywhere in America. So I think his not being forward in confronting slavery is that he has, he's so into thinking about, reading about the history of traditional societies in Europe, and most of which had, or many of which had slaves at some point. So he doesn't see it as a problem. But then he turns and thinking as an American, thinking about the Republican America, he says, well, we've got to have education for everybody. And this, of course, would absolutely undermine slavery very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would just add to that that there's a letter, I think, written around 1801, I'm not sure, but where Adams responds to friends who are much more anti-slavery than he was, and it becomes apparent that Adams was anti-slavery while also being sanguine about the slavery problem, in the sense that the idea that Adams conveys is that he thinks that slavery is more or less on its way out. So it's not really an urgent problem that should be at the forefront of our concerns, because the natural drift of events is taking care of it. I think he should be criticized for that, because in his own lifetime, in the previous 10 years, slavery had actually expanded substantially, and he would turn out to be profoundly wrong in the subsequent decades. The structures of slavery would just grow deeper and deeper, and the problem would grow more and more urgent and severe.
His attitude, his saying this, by the way, was very common, in particularly in Virginia, among sort of optimistic slaveholders who said, mm-hmm. well, this problem's going to go away. Even Jefferson said this. Not so common in the North, and in New England, I'd say it was somewhat less common to say, well, this problem's going to naturally resolve itself, you know.
Let's end by bringing Adams to the present day. What advice do you think Adams would give the current administration on how to drain the swamp in Washington, or can it be done at all? So quickly to each of you, if you want to give any thoughts about that.
Well, it was advice for the current president?
Or the administration, okay. Or Washington, okay. Or, you know.
I would be better equipped to say, to give advice to the voters. One thing that I recently discovered is that in spite of the aspiration to drain the swamp, the new cabinet has a combined wealth that's greater than the combined GDP of the poorest 39 countries in the world. And One of the themes of Adams's writings, when he looked back at the history of republics, was the vulnerability of chief executives in relation to the oligarchs. And this long history of the ways, and Richard described earlier, the ways that the aristocrats or the oligarchs would subvert the chief executive and would more or less capture it and turn it into an instrument. And it would seem, to the extent that Adams is right about that tendency in the history of republics, it would seem that when we make decisions about whom to elect as president, we ought to do so with that in mind. We ought to do so with the idea in mind that being president requires a kind of hyper-vigilance about the danger that oligarchs can pose to executives, and the need for them to maintain their own integrity as an office holder apart from the influences. Because Adams might say there's a natural tendency of for a swamp to surround the executive. And it takes a great deal of vigilance to prevent that from happening.
And Dick, any final thoughts on what Adams' account of aristocracy could teach folks in Washington today?
Well, I think I want to say just something about this phrase, draining the swamp. Presidents have an enormous amount of power under the Constitution, and a president can drain the swamp, or at least can begin to drain the swamp. But the president has to want to drain the swamp. He has to think it's a good idea to drain the swamp. There's been a lot of talk about this phrase, and a lot of people have somehow bought into the idea that the current president wanted to drain the swamp. And actually, if one looks back at this, this seems to be a phrase that was kind of put on the president as a candidate. And as Lucas pointed out, there seems to have been no attention whatsoever to this in choosing the cabinet. Not every person appointed is necessarily an example of wealth aristocracy. Many are. Many represent other kinds of interests or whatever. But Trump is not the first president who has said, I don't know who the first one was, Trump is not the first president who said that he thinks America is a wonderful place because people can become wealthy. He's not the first one to say he really likes people who have done a wonderful job making money, who've become wealthy, who've become successful businessmen. I think probably several presidents have said this. And my own view is that if you actually do believe that, you're not in any position to try to drain the swamp at all. It's just going to stay right where it is, particularly with so many of the members of the Senate already deeply immersed in this themselves. I think the American public seems to have some notion that the swamp, the problem of the swamp is these bureaucrats that they don't like in the federal government. My personal opinion is that's not the problem. It isn't the problem of the bureaucrats, who are often very dedicated people who don't get paid very much to do hard work and then get insulted. The problem is the lobbyists, the interests, many of the representatives, many of the senators, and some presidents we have had in the 20th and 21st century. That's what is keeping the swamp well filled up. If you want to drain the swamp as voters, you need to think, who's keeping it filled up and who would help drain it? And Adams would tell you that it is a problem of aristocracy, aristocracy of wealth, aristocracy of birth. Many of the wealthy people involved in government today came from quite affluent families. They weren't all Abe Lincolns or anything like that, you know. Or John D. Rockefellers, since he started with nothing. They weren't entirely that. Many of them are second, third, fourth generation millionaires, billionaires, whatever. If the voters are comfortable with that, then that's fine. If they're not comfortable, they have to recognize where the problem really lies, I think.
Thank you so much for that, Dick. Thank you, everyone, for being here. There will be a book signing and sale outside afterwards. So Luke Mayville, Richard Allen Ryerson, thank you so much. Luke.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Dick, thank you so much. That was so much fun.